Hi, my name's Shawn, and I'm a 20-year smoker, no more. Pretty happy about that pack and a half a day that I was doing. And now I've been doing the electronic cigarette. I'm here to talk to you about health concerns, and I know that a lot of us should have that, as this is a pretty new thing that has come into our society here, especially in the United States. On a world scale, you've been looking at about 6 years, and as far as negative things happening, death, serious illness, things of that nature, if you look around, nothing has been found about this. I'm not here to tell you whether this is good for you, whether it's bad or indifferent. What I am here to tell you about is do your homework, which I know none of us like to do. I will point you in the right direction. Things that I personally did as soon as I picked up this particular habit. Now, for me personally, what is my experience that I've had with this? This has been about 2 months. Major difference from smoking for 20 years. Of course, I breathe better. Blood pressure's down, which is nice. Tastes better. Have more energy. Pretty much a lot of things that you would have if you weren't smoking a cigarette, right? And that is what I've personally experienced with this. Now, I did have some concern as far as what the liquid was that I was inhaling, and I really did look into that quite deeply. And I do know, where a lot of people would, that if you have a buildup of a liquid in your lungs, sometimes your lungs can't get rid of that, and that is a concern to have. So came across something fairly recently, and it was interesting because this was kind of jumped on by a lot of the electronic cigarette stores. They had pointed out an article that was done back in the 1940s. I, of course, did look at that, but I dug a little bit deeper, and where I dug into was what the actual results were done on that test. It's very interesting because this electronic cigarette that you see right here, the way that it works, if you've never seen one of these before, major portion of it is a battery. They're commonly a three-piece or a two-piece model. This is a three-piece model. This also has an atomizer, and then the cartridge, this area right here, has liquid in it, and the atomizer heats it up, turns it into a smoke-like vapor. It hits your throat. You hear that throat hit like smoke does. It's warm. It has, of course, flavor to it, nicotine, things of that nature. So it's a really easy thing to move over from regular tobacco use, your traditional tobacco use, as you're still keeping that same hand-to-mouth habit, as they're saying. So it has been successful for a lot of people. If you do read around and you look at different forums, as far as they've tried to gum, they tried to patch, now they've tried this, and it's been pretty good for them. Let's get into the liquid itself. Primarily, the liquid, the base of the liquid, is propylene glycol. Propylene glycol you can find in a lot of food-grade materials such as snow cones, things of that nature. But more importantly, having a snow cone and inhaling something is completely different. It is, of course, being absorbed in your body in a different way, and it is a concern to have. The 1940 report, it was done exactly on Monday, November 16, 1942, that this particular article was brought out. A powerful preventative against pneumonia, influenza, and respiratory diseases. Influenza, as we all know, is the flu. Be promised by a brilliant series of experiments conducted during the last 3 years at the University of Chicago Billings Hospital. Dr. Oswald Hope Robertson last week was making final tests with a new germicidal vapor, propylene glycol, to sterilize the air. Now, when you look at this particular article, a little bit far-fetched. They were considering putting something in the air, pumping it into movie theaters, schools, things of that nature, to try to defeat the flu, influenza, and things that you have. Hypothetically, that's a great thing, but seeing it pumped in through all public places, that's a little bit far-fetched. But what we're after right now, everybody, is what the report was, because here we are in 2009, and propylene glycol has come back on the scene as a major ingredient for an electronic cigarette. I'm also very curious why this was not ever brought up in the FDA report that was recently done, as here you have something that is conclusive evidence of what the effects are of this to a human being. So let's go into this very quickly. Trouble was all the other air germicides smell bad, toxic, irritating, toxic, that's a problem. Irritated the respiratory tract, etc. Dr. Robertson's propylene glycol vapor is odorless, tasteless, non-toxic, non-irritating, cheap, and highly effective. And this is, it does come as odorless, the things that you have there. Of course, they do put in flavoring. That's where you're getting all of these different flavors. You can get everything from peach flavor to tobacco flavor, things of that nature. Of course, how did it work? Respiratory disease bacteria floats around in tiny droplets of water, breathe, sneeze, and cough. We all know that. It's how human beings normally contract the different flus and things of that nature. Now, on this particular one that you have here, Dr. Robinson placed groups of mice in a chamber, poor little mice, and sprayed its air with propylene glycol and, of course, with a virus, with the flu. All the mice lived. Then he sprayed the chamber with just the virus alone, and they all died. Like I said, poor little mice. Tom and Jerry. I always think of Jerry when I see that. Propylene glycol is harmless to man when swallowed or injected into the veins. It is also harmless to mice who also breathed it in for long periods of time. But medical science is cautious. There was still a remote chance that glycol might accumulate harmfully in the erect lungs of a human being. And that was something that I was curious about too, because our lungs aren't built where they drain fluids. And as you know, when you're inhaling something like this, it's not smoke, it's actually a water like vapor. What's happening to our lungs? This is something that has been really brought out a lot, like I said, but nobody really dug really deep to see what the conclusions of the tests were. Like I said, this was done in 1942. I did do a lot of snooping around and finally found the medical logs for the conclusion of this test. And just so everybody knows, this is available on my website, eCigs.com. You go to, you just click on health concerns, you can see the full report and everything of that nature. So it's not just a guy here on YouTube, Shawn, telling you that it is good. Like I said, do your homework, check it out yourself. All right, so first thing that you're noticing on this particular report that was done is a number of a lot of other experts. Robertson, of course, was part of this, and then you have one, two, three, four, five other experts that were there to conclude on all of these tests and were present while all of this was done. From the Department of Medicine, Douglas Smith Foundation for Medical Research, and the Bartlett Memorial Fund of the University of Chicago, and the Commission on Airborne Infectious. That's, of course, a U.S. Army board. With a view to determining the safety of employing the vapor of propylene glycol and in the atmosphere, and of course, inhabited by human beings, that's all of us here, monkeys and rats were exposed continuously to a high concentration of these vapors for a period of 12 to 18 months, quite a long time. Now, equal number of controlled animals were maintained under the physically similar conditions. The doses administered, and look at this, man, 50 to 700 times the amount of glycol that an animal could absorb, and as we all know, human beings are animals too. So, I mean, just a high amount that they were using on all of this. Comparative observations on the growth rates, blood counts, urinary examinations, kidney function tests, fertility, and general condition of the test groups exhibited no essential differences between the rats and, of course, the monkeys with the glycol atmospheres and the ones that were not in that atmosphere. Examination of the autopsy. Poor monkeys. I don't condone that, but it is what it is, and I'm looking at something from the 1940s, so let's just take it what it is. Let's not have a topic about animal cruelty. I do understand that. Let's look at this here. Examination of the autopsy likewise failed to reveal any difference between the animals kept in glycolized air and those living in ordinary room atmosphere. Extensive studies of the lungs were made to ascertain whether the glycol had produced any generalized or local irritation. None was found. The kidneys, liver, spleen, and bone marrow also were normal. The results of these experiments, in conjunction with the absence of any observed ill effects in patients exposed to propylene glycol vapors for months at a time, provide assurance that air containing these vapors in the amounts up to the saturation points is completely harmless. This was submitted on June 4th, 1947. So I'm not saying that we just take this and that's it. This is the safest thing in the world, things of that nature, but it definitely puts us in the right direction. There was a study that was done on this, and it was done in the 1940s. This is, of course, historic evidence of what propylene glycol does to the human body. And like I said, as a majority, that is, of course, the major component of this particular unit that you are using. Can you actually not get the flu by using this? There's a good possibility that it can defeat the flu, so that's kind of interesting to know about that too. So in a nutshell, I'm trying to put you in the right direction to look for, of course, health concerns with this particular product. And I welcome you to the electronic cigarette world if you haven't been there. My name's Sean, and you can check out my website, ZeeCigs.com. I have a lot of different information. If you're just getting into this, you've been a long-time smoker, you want to change things like gum, whatever it might be, has failed, try this.